This program is recorded and presented by Chippewa Valley Community Television. This is a rebroadcast of the Eau Claire School Board meeting. The audio for this program can be heard on WRFP LP 101.9 FM.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to call to order the April 3rd, 2017 Eau Claire School District Board of Education meeting. I again thank our school board commissioners for their commitment to serve, our superintendent and all others in our district for their hard work, keeping us focused on children and their individual needs. We thank you greatly. Lastly, I want to thank Chippewa Valley Community Television again, I always try to do that, for broadcasting our meeting and holding it for future use. And good evening to those that are listening on the web tonight. So thank you all for coming. That's meaningful for us as a board that you're here. So let's stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So, Patty, are we in compliance with the Wisconsin Open Meetings Law?
Yes, we are.
Thank you for posting all that stuff to make us be compliant. And would you please take a roll call for verification of a quorum, please?
Commissioner Barstead?
Here.
Commissioner Duax?
Here.
Commissioner Fager?
Here.
Commissioner Hambuck Boyle?
I'm here.
Commissioner Harder?
Here.
Commissioner Luganbill?
Here.
Commissioner Boo?
Here.
So we start every meeting with our public forum. It is the part of our meeting that we give up to 30 minutes to allow citizens from our community to address the board and express your thoughts and concerns. We can't really interact or have a conversation with you, but know that what you say is written down and we do talk about it as a board. So we have up to 30 minutes, but 4 minutes per person, and we have two people on our list tonight. So when you come up, please state your name and your address for us, please. And the first person on the list is Megan Holman. Hello, Megan.
Good evening. Good evening. My name is Megan Holman of 1727 West Mead Street. I am here on behalf of 135 parents out of 237 families at Roosevelt Elementary. Dear Dr. Hardebeck, President Hambuck Boyle, and members of the board, as proud parents of Roosevelt Tigers, we thank you for your support in recognizing that Roosevelt has space and enrollment issues. We appreciate the Demographic Trends and Facility Planning Committee proposing the idea of a new building to replace Roosevelt. Thank you for your support in bringing this to referendum in the fall of 2020 or 21. We are confident that there is a design out there that will be perfect for the future of Roosevelt Elementary that voters will approve and support. While the idea of making Roosevelt a three-section school is very exciting, we know that this is a long-term solution. In the meantime, we need to ensure that our district and community are doing what is best for our students and ensuring that we meet the targeted class sizes presented by the district. Thankfully, due to our November 2016 referendum passing, our district now has the opportunity to invest in quality teachers and meet the targeted class sizes of 19 to 25 students in grades K through 3 and 21 to 29 students in grades 4 and 5. According to the Center for Public Education, research shows that as class size is reduced in the primary grades of K through 3, student achievement improves. We understand that we cannot do this, that we cannot reduce class sizes physically at Roosevelt due to space restrictions. However, we do know that adding certified teachers to team teach in our classrooms would give Roosevelt a better student to teacher ratio, thus allowing our children to be more successful academically. Not only would teaming benefit our students, it would also benefit Roosevelt's teachers by reducing their workload, such as time spent on parent-teacher conferences, report cards, grading papers, and it would optimize their abilities to connect with each child as well as with parents. The Eau Claire Area School District has put a large emphasis on educating the whole child. Providing additional teachers meets this crucial objective in enabling educators not only to meet the academic development of our Roosevelt Tigers, but also their social and emotional developments. Currently, many of the grade levels at Roosevelt are at or above target class sizes, and this will likely be the same in the 2017-2018 school year. We request that team teaching be considered once the target class size has been met, rather than the addition of support staff. Support staff rarely have the background, training, or licensure to teach and are split between multiple classrooms. Each student should have access to learn material from a certified teacher who will challenge the higher level thinkers and assist those who need additional support. We understand that support staff costs the district less money than a certified educator. However, we feel the best option for our students is to be taught by someone with the knowledge of best teaching strategies and practices. Thank you for your time, your service, and your consideration. We care about our Tigers, and we want to make sure that all students have the opportunity to fully apply themselves and engage in their whole child development. Sincerely, the Roosevelt Tiger parents. Our Roosevelt Tigers deserve the same opportunity to learn as the rest of the students in the district. I would like to remind the board that when we talk about target class sizes, the district is assuming that each physical classroom size is equal. I personally would like to urge the equity committee to review this, given the fact that each classroom varies in size. The kindergarten, first, and second grade classrooms at Roosevelt Elementary are smaller than their equivalents at other elementary schools in Eau Claire. The dimensions of each classroom should be considered when determining a targeted class size for the number of students in a room and the student-to-teacher ratio. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Megan, is that Emma with you?
This is Emma.
Hi, Emma.
Hi.
Did you come with your mama tonight?
Yeah.
Thank you for being so civic-minded. Are you going to speak now?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Hello. My name is Emma, and I am in second grade at Roosevelt Elementary School. I have 25 kids in my class. In first grade, I had 27 kids in my class. When kids are being loud, the teacher has to stop, and that time adds up so we get less time to learn important skills. Kids get tired of the other kids that hold up the classroom learning. On the carpet, you don't have the self-space that you need. It also takes up space when we have a test. There is no space to walk around if you need something. In the morning, it's hard to concentrate on your work because of the noise level in the room. Believe it or not, it's even hard to get through a simple story. It also takes more time to pass things out with a large class. If we had two teachers, each teacher could have 13 students. That would help with tests so kids could get help faster. It would also help manage the behaviors of children who are misbehaving. During dailies, each teacher could work with a group. During writing, one teacher could help out while the other teacher could teach. With two teachers, one teacher could teach and the lower students, and the other could teach the higher students. This would make Roosevelt a better place. Thank you.
Thank you. Could we have copies of your, please? Thank you. Thanks, Emma. You gonna run for school board someday? We need people. So that concludes our public forum part of our meeting. Thank you very much. And we go on to board and administrative reports to our superintendent, Dr. Marianne Hardebeck. Dr. Hardebeck.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I'd like to review the upcoming events for the Board of Education. Tomorrow night at 7 p.m. in the administration building is the meeting of the Parent Advisory Council. On April 5th at 11:30 a.m. here in the administration building is the meeting of the Budget Development Committee. That will be followed at 5 p.m. by a meeting of the Demographic Trends and Facilities Planning Committee. On April 6th at 6 p.m. Wild Ridge Golf Course, we will hold the Golden Apple Awards Banquet. On April 10th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. at the Administration Building, there will be a meeting of the Equity Review Committee. On April 11th from 4 to 6 p.m., there will be a meeting of the LEAP Committee. And then those meetings will be followed April 17th with policy and governance meeting at 8 a.m. and a school board meeting at 7 p.m. And all of those meetings will take place in the administration building. So tonight we have some recognitions, and our first recognition is North High School junior Josie Kelly. Josie, where are you? Would you stand up, please? Josie was recently honored at the American Red Cross Northwest Wisconsin Heroes Breakfast at the Florian Gardens. Josie was nominated by North teacher Ms. Mariah Fundheller, and she received the American Red Cross Youth Good Samaritan Award. Josie's an active volunteer and a member of Circle of Friends, which is a group at North that brings together general education and special education students to form lasting friendships. Josie plays a large role in planning activities for the group, and Josie and her parents, and you want to stand up? Be recognized too. And Mrs. Fundheller are with us tonight, so Mariah, stand up too. So thank you. Great, thank you. We also received notification last week about recipients of the 2017 Herb Cole Education Foundation Awards, and North Senior Emily Schmidt and Memorial Senior Emma Lauer received Student Excellence Scholarships and will each receive a $5,000 scholarship. So Emily is here tonight with her parents, Jim and Cheryl Schmidt, and you want to stand up, Emily? Yeah, stand up too. Recognize some familiar faces. And Emma will be with us at a later meeting. So these Excellence in Scholarship recipients have demonstrated excellence in the academic area and high motivation to achieve. They've displayed a broad range of activity and leadership outside the academic setting, and they've shown strong promise for succeeding in college and beyond. So congratulations. And we also want to recognize North Star teacher Brenda Shong. Brenda, stand up. she received the Teacher Fellowship Award and will receive $3,000. Teacher Fellowship recipients are educators who have been chosen for their superior ability to inspire a love of learning in their students, their ability to motivate others, and their leadership and service within and outside the classroom. And I think you're here tonight with your principal, Mr. Scootley. They didn't come. That's why we have principals. So as I stated earlier, this Thursday we will celebrate the Golden Apple Awards, and this is our second year. 20 employees will be recognized for their exemplary service as educators. Those who will be honored have been nominated and selected by their peers. It's kind of like, I guess, the Oscars of education. The award comes with a cash award of $1,000, $500 for the educators' use in their classrooms, and $500 for each school. Bob Gallagher of WEAU will be emceeing the event, and he has created a video, kind of a history of the award winners' reactions this year as they were notified of their selections. So it should be a fun and inspiring evening. I also want to point out that last week was the annual Chippewa Valley Spirit Awards, sponsored by the United Way. And the district was recognized with a 2016 Pillar Award. This award is given for having contributions of $60 or more average employee gift for companies with five or more donors. Over 50 organizations received this distinction, including CVTC, Cascade Tissue Group, Dairyland Power Cooperative, E.O. Johnson Business Technologies, the Chamber of Commerce, Sacred Heart, the Mayo Clinic Health System, Royal Credit Union, Skills, Macy's, Marshall Clinic, just to name a few. And I think this is an example ECASD's partnering with community organizations, which is part of our strategic plan, but it speaks really to the generosity and the commitment of our employees to the community and to helping the community at large. So I did want to mention that. I also want to congratulate the Arctic Zone students at North Star for their exhibition of learning. This was their first exhibition, and its theme was Heroes, and it is a project-based learning approach to instruction. And it is one of the projects of our Innovation Zone Committee, which is part of our strategic plan. And I think this is an important benchmark for the Innovation Zone programs, and it was a great opportunity for the students to show their work to their teachers and also to their parents. So congratulations to the Arctic Zone students. And then I'm going to ask that you mark your calendars for May 25th from 5 to 7 p.m. because Mann's will be celebrating their 50th birthday. And in preparation for that celebration, they have fourth grade class who's under the supervision of teacher Steve Winters. And they have lots of things planned for that afternoon. And I think they've done lots and lots of research about the school and also about the time that the school was founded. They had a lot of stories about things like mimeograph machines and that kind of thing. This is another example of project-based learning, and they're really putting their research skills to work in a really relevant way. So they have a time capsule that was buried at the time that the building was built, and they're going to open that time capsule, and then they're going to bury another time capsule. So sounds like it's going to be a fun evening. I hope that all of you can attend. Thank you. It's May 25th from 5 to 7 p.m. at the school.
Okay. Thank you for coming, families. We're going to go on now to the president's report, my report, so let me get to it here. I want to start out, we have some correspondence that I will send to the board, around to the board tonight as we sit here, you can read it. It is from the NSTA Convention Science Crew. It was Sue Devine, Scott Hayden, Tim Kamlick, Nikki Bredigan, Rachel Borenson, Kristen Solberg, Brenda Zhang, Nick Sirik, Jeff Bovey, Jeremy Trainer, Lars Long, Susan Vanderil, and Allie Ruse went to Los Angeles for the NSTA convention, and they're thanking the board for the opportunity to be able to do this deeper learning. So they sent a picture and a thank you card. So let's pass it around and read it. What fun. So I'll pass it that way, and then it can come back this way as well. Okay, I want to start my president's report tonight by thanking Carolyn Barstead for the hard work, commitment, and personal contribution of time and energy she's given the Eau Claire Area School District School Board this past year. Carolyn has modeled the integrity, additional learning, and community connections that was integral to passing our recent referendum. Every time I turned around, Carolyn was there to help. The board, our superintendent, and staff owe you a great deal of gratitude. We are going to miss you, so you better make sure that you come to some board meetings in the future so the district will continue to benefit from the love you have for all of the staff and children of the Eau Claire Area School District. So we have a little certificate here. Do you have anything to say? You don't need to, but
I probably can if you want. I probably have a ton to say. As I came on board at the election last year, I felt that I knew quite a bit because I taught in the school system for practically my whole career, short of semester, and worked at many of the different schools in the classroom, in the English department and in the counseling departments. So I thought I was getting on board with a lot of extra knowledge. That was not true. I felt like I was in kindergarten again, actually, because I really needed to start from the beginning and learn what a school board member does. And I have to say to anybody that will listen to me, I am so impressed with your Board of Education and the hours and hours and hours that board members put in to make our schools the best schools in the world, as far as I'm concerned. I could go down one after another and tell you how much each of these members of the Board of Education helped me. And I'm after this whole year on the board, I'm still not up to speed with a lot of the things that are going on in the district. It's a big learning experience, and it's been a great experience for me. Everybody has helped me as much as possible and worked with me as much as possible. This group is a wonderful group to work with. I would recommend that anytime to anybody, get involved in what's happening in the schools in Eau Claire. I appreciate this experience, and I thank all of you very, very much.
Thanks, Carolyn. So the board, with Carolyn leaving the board, I want to remind the Eau Claire community that we are taking applications to fill her board seat. Patty, can you pull up the application page, which we'll show you in a minute. Applications are due by April 12th. The applications will then be distributed to the remaining board members with a vote at our next board meeting on April 17th. The applicants will address the board on the 17th. A vote will be taken with the candidate immediately sworn into office and will assume their commission that same night. Our policy allows this to do it, and we did a timeline so that the seat would never be vacant. So we're hoping to have people apply. So is there anything on the website, Patty, they should know about?
No, it's right. Everything can be found under the Board of Education tab. If you just click on that, there's links to the application and the process also if anybody has questions.
Okay, or call Patty because she knows all of that stuff. Okay. Joint finance hearings are coming up. I shared the dates and places at our last board meeting. Joe and I, we talked today because we were in policy and governance afterwards. I think we are both going up on Tuesday to Spooner on April 18th to testify. There's also an opportunity to participate in Ellsworth on Wednesday, April 19th. Anyone in support of public education may want to get on their shoes and write up a testimony in support of public schools. Or I was going to say, when I did the budget advocacy training here in Eau Claire on February 26th, these trainings were held all over Wisconsin through a partnership between Citizen Action Cooperative and the Wisconsin Public Education Network, of which we are members. We spent a day learning how to coach people in telling their stories to advocate for public schools, mental health, healthcare, environment. So it isn't just public schools. I wore my green shirt last board meeting, which is being encouraged for those testifying for the public schools. Catherine is very diligently wearing her green shirt tonight. We have one up here, and I can get green shirts. People all over the state will be reading Go Public School shirts all over the state of Wisconsin at these public hearings. And that's an initiative through the Wisconsin Public Education Network. Let me see. So, from that training, I can offer services to coach anyone who wants to tell their story or to either share in person, or you can submit it to the committee. We're making copies of everything submitted so that we will have a record of what was presented to our legislators. Let me see what else here. The other thing is, if you don't feel comfortable testifying, you certainly can come and stand next to the people who are, especially if you know them, and give them some moral support. Also, if you go by yourself, Citizen Action and the Wisconsin Public Education Network will be at all the hearings with a designated place in the parking lot that you can go for help, you can buy a shirt. And Joe's going to talk a little bit more about some of the budget points in his legislative report tonight. So any questions from the board? No. There's going to be lots of support. I don't think anything's ever been put together this logistically for the Joint Finance Committee hearings before, so hopefully that will work out well. There are two other things here too that I pulled up from the district update just for board members. I thought it was interesting to see the lecture regarding cultural relevant teaching. That's open to everyone, and that is at 4 o'clock at the University Gantner Concert Hall on April 13th. It looked interesting, and if you have the time, it might be good to get that topic of culturally relevant teaching, you know, as an understanding as a board member. And the other one was, please, every year I go to celebrate the retirements of the people from the Eau Claire School District, and that's the celebration of service. And if at all that you could attend as a board member, it would be greatly appreciated to honor the people that have given so much for our school district. And it's on Wednesday, May 24th at Florian Gardens, dinner starting at 6 o'clock with gathering before that. So, and I end, and I meant to go over to that board, so maybe somebody in the audience can do that, but remember to vote tomorrow with a big V-O-T-E, okay? And that concludes my president's report. And that will take us on to the student representative report. So, Ryan, it's your turn.
North hosted a solo ensemble this past weekend, and 35 of our students qualified at the state competition in either band, orchestra, or choir. We also had four powerlifters compete at nationals recently in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and all four of them placed in the top 10.
Where were they?
Scranton, Pennsylvania. As we approach the last quarter of our school year, I am planning on putting out a small survey at North regarding their views on course options along with block scheduling, since those topics have been brought up in the past. I'd love to work with Student Council or other clubs to put this survey together and distribute it to students.
Thanks, Ryan. Anything else? Well done. Okay. That goes on to board committee reports, so I'll go to my list here. We didn't do them the last meeting, so we're going to catch up on board committee reports. Now, as we do these committees, I'm thinking to save time for people in the length of our board meetings, we might just maybe do these once a month now. We do get an update in our board packet, but I think it's important for our community to know publicly all the committees and what's being worked on. So we'll do kind of a condensed version. Anyone who wants to have a longer version of what's going on in our committees, I'm certainly, we could provide that, right? So I'm going to start with Budget Development Committee, and I think tonight that's you, Aaron Harder. Thanks, Commissioner Harder.
Thank you. The Budget Committee met last Wednesday. We covered quite a few topics. Right off the bat, we spent some significant time reviewing the married couples insurance policy that this board passed on March 6th. We did clarify some misunderstandings that I and several others on the committee had about the implications of the new married couples policy. In particular, the fact that one effect of the policy is to entirely eliminate any benefit for married couples who choose the open access plan as compared to individual staff members. Now, how so many of us missed that detail is maybe another question, but the point is, I think everyone looking at this issue agrees, that we must better reflect and pass on the costs of open access. I think there was also general agreement that our wish is not to completely eliminate a married couple benefit. So the proposal passed on March 6th did have that effect. So apologies to the board for our misunderstanding on that point. But the good news is we have a chance to rectify it with a second vote on a revised proposal, some details of which you will have received in the Friday letter. We're hopeful that the board will approve that revised recommendation in a future meeting. We also got a brief update on the results of the compensation letter that was sent out to staff. As of last Wednesday, there were about 30 letters received in response back, and the full board will be getting a report on these findings from the responses soon. We had an update on the extended day contract, salary schedule that we voted on in December. 35 staff were affected by this transition. Some have raised some concerns about moving backwards and had some questions about it. I guess the committee as a whole, I would say, is waiting to hear more details on the findings from the executive team on what happened there and what the outcome is. Some of those may be coming in as responses to the compensation letter. If not, then I expect we'll hear a follow-up in some other form, maybe later in the month. We also briefly discussed OPEB, which is an ongoing topic. We'll be getting a second presentation from our professional advisor later this month in hopes of sort of zeroing in on some viable OPEB options to bring forward. We also discussed equity, general open access utilization costs, facility rental fees, and so it was a fairly packed agenda for last week's meeting. And we're meeting again this Wednesday, so there's more to come.
Thanks, Commissioner Harder. The next is Demographic Trends and Facility Planning Council. Commissioner Fager.
Demographics and Trends met last week, and we're meeting again this week to discuss some redistricting options and equity options with regard to enrollment at the two high schools. And those conversations are ongoing.
Thank you, Commissioner. The next, there's not been any joint commission shared services, no. Go on to the LEAP committee, that's me, is currently focusing on two efforts, the development of policy rules to facilitate an understandable process for innovation zone submissions, and two, the identification and definition of dimensions of learning, which is pretty exciting. This work is being accomplished with the assistance of Michelle Radke and several of the teaching and learning coordinators in collaboration with the Learning Environments and Programming Committee. There should be a draft version of the various dimensions and their definitions and performance outcomes to share with LEAP meeting in April. We also received an Innovation Zone Step 1 Imagination Narrative from the grade 4 teachers at Roosevelt. So there is an interest in exploring learning environments and instructional practices. We also spent a major portion of the meeting talking with Bill Giese from Sam Davey. He's the principal, about their InTech Great Innovation Zone at Sam Davey. They are in a six-year development, and presently they're developing to enhance and augment their defined innovation. So it was nice to bring that in and get an update from that as well. I have the PowerPoint for board members if they'd like to see the information. That's it from the Learning Environments and Programming Committee, or otherwise known as LEAP. Next one on here is Policy and Governance, and that's Joe Luganbill, the head of the committee. Joe?
Good evening. So I'll report first on our meeting that we had on the 27th. We covered two major areas of discussion. One, policy changes to policy 345.5, updating our practices and replacing our class rank process. So Jim Schmidt will be meeting with principals, department chairs, and we'll also have the officers of the Honor Society reviewing that policy, and they'll be able to discuss the timeline and implementation and bring us back some feedback. We also talked about our facility use again at our committee, and we had representative from the YMCA and also from Parks and Recreation with the City of Eau Claire, who made some additional changes and asked some additional questions. So we'll get some more updates on that in the coming weeks. Today at our committee meeting, we discussed our new policy changes on school resource officers, clarifying a number of different areas. The police department is in support of our policy changes, and we moved to bring that to a future board meeting. We also discussed policy 347 on student records, our policy on student directory data, and our district opt-out form. And really, the three of those together connect quite well, so we'll be discussing more at our meeting in 2 weeks about those. And we also had Larry Sommerfeld with us, Director of Buildings and Grounds, and he helped us with drafting a new sustainability policy for a school district. So that will go to a future board meeting as well. And he also brought us a sustainability report, which we were able to read through today as we looked at a possible new policy. And so I know that will go to you in a future Friday letter. It's really great to see all the work that's being done and really kind of leading the way in a lot of areas as a school district. So that's all I have for P&G.
Thanks, Commissioner Luganville. We're going to go on to the advisory committees quick. Equity Committee, Commissioner Duex.
The Equity Committee met last week, and we will meet again on April 10. We had quite a few people visit us at the last meeting trying to clarify what our committee really, what our purpose was. And I just want to say for the record that we were charged with understanding how donations are made to the district and if they are equitable. And there were lots and lots of questions. People didn't seem, the booster clubs thought we were trying to work with their fundraising, but that's not our purpose at all. It's to deal with the donations and see how they're being used. So we have a president, a vice president, and a couple of other people have joined those two people, and they will start writing recommendations before the next meeting. So I'm looking forward to see what they have on their minds.
Thank you, Catherine. And I think it was brought up about equity and class size and all that. This, our equity committee right now is focused on the fund, the donations, and so if, and gifts. And so if we would look at other equity issues, we would form another committee. Okay. The next one on here is the Parent Advisory Council, Dr. Hardebeck.
So the March meeting of Parent Advisory Council began with review of the items that we had discussed in February when our program was about academic interventions. And the council had some questions about the various interventions. And so we spent some time trying to organize to see how to best bring those questions forward. And we decided to have a survey for the PAC committee. And that survey was sent out. And we got feedback mostly from the secondary representatives, a lot of interest in the retake policy, how it's working, is it making a difference, that kind of thing. That will be the topic of tomorrow night's meeting. The program for the March meeting was about summer school, and we reviewed the summer school catalog with the PAC Council, got some feedback about it. It was just ready to go to press, so that was very helpful. We explained our full day approach and our partnerships with our 17 community partners in our summer school, and the idea that lunch will be available, breakfast will be available. It's almost wraparound care in our summer school programs, and we're very excited about these partnerships. Again, it goes back to our strategic plan and our whole child approach. So that was very well received. The May meeting will most likely focus on recommendations from the Demographic and Trends Committee, and they have asked to come to the Parent Advisory Council to get feedback about any proposals that they're making. So we're looking forward to the May meeting as well.
Thank you very much. The next on here is Special Education Liaison. Nope. Wellness Committee. Nope. Okay. Foundation. Nope. Head Start Policy. I did have a meeting, so I'll quickly go through what we did at that meeting. Head Start shared Heidi and her crew about the professional development focus right now is conscious discipline. They're very excited about this. It's a whole school culture for social-emotional learning, learning for learning, social-emotional learning, discipline, and self-regulation. And it allows adults to consciously respond to daily conflict, transforming it into an opportunity to teach critical life skills to children. Interestingly, there's a heightened awareness of brain development and all the things that impact the social-emotional responses of children. And they're connecting it to developmentally appropriate practice. as is cautious discipline is considered an evidence-based practice. They're continuing to work on decreasing their absences. Heidi's made many home visits, as has her staff, to work with families on having them understand the importance of learning that you have to be there in order to have that happen, along with their strong connection to their families. Head Start invites input from parents at each meeting or in their center as well on health and nutrition. We always go over that piece. And then we went over a lot of the child outcomes data from their Teaching Strategies Gold progress monitoring system. They've had it in place long enough now that they're able to make some predictions, which has been really fun to watch and be a part of. So, and the meeting ended with the listing of all their many events that they have been doing for families, which you can find on their website. So that's my report from Head Start. McKinley, is there anything from McKinley?
No, I don't really have a report from McKinley, but I would like to urge the board in two directions. One, Prairie Ridge, it has a real soft spot in my heart because I think that that's probably the most or very close to the most important school in our school district. And I think McKinley is the other one. I feel very strongly that those two schools are where we need to put a lot of effort and care with our students. And I hope that will continue. And there will have to be another person representing the board from the board, because I've been doing that, and I wish you well, and I hope that things go well with that. The meetings were always interesting, and has a good board. I would recommend that would be a spot that somebody would really like to be.
Thanks, Carolyn. I think it's fun too, as a board. I've just heard over and over again that we have three high schools. And I think we need to keep saying that over and over again, because we do have three high schools, McKinley being one of them. Okay, Montessori, did they meet, Jen?
Yes, the Montessori School Board met today. However, I wasn't able to attend because I was in a car between here and Chicago.
Commissioner Fager arrived back in Eau Claire about 10 minutes before the meeting tonight, so we appreciate that you're here. The last one on our list is the Wisconsin Public Education Network. I'm the liaison. I have nothing more to say except that they will continue to provide the support at the Joint Finance Committee hearings. So you'll see them out there supporting public schools. So that concludes our committee reports. Anybody else have anything else? No? So we will go on to our legislative update with Commissioner Luganbill.
So we had our day at the Capitol at WASB, which was a really interesting experience for me to represent the district at. That was on March 15th. Just haven't had the chance to report on it. The major WASB legislative agenda items, there are three this year. Number one, preserving governance of publicly funded schools by locally elected boards with respect to unfunded state mandates, school district takeover proposals, and the expansion of voters and independent charters. Number two is supporting increased funding for meeting unmet student mental health needs that interfere with student learning. And number three is providing, of course, necessary resources for public schools. And that includes inflationary catch-up adjustments to school district resources and an additional $200 per student, and many more. But so we heard from the two candidates for state superintendent while we were there. Then we headed over to the Capitol. We had meetings with a number of folks, including Dana Wachs and Kathleen Weinhout's office. Where there we talked a lot about transparency with regard to the voucher programs, and talked about the proposed aid increases and where we go from there. Met with Kathleen Bernier and talked about, with her, the major topics were DPI regulations, aid increases, the start date legislation, and then fair funding, which she's talked quite a bit about lately. And then with Senator Moulton, we talked about aid increases, fair funding, and the start date legislation. I know that President Humbuck Boyle has talked quite a bit about the joint finance hearings. They are very crucial right now. And the big why is because there is a huge divide right now among lawmakers, just this week, last week, the week before, about how to deal with Governor Walker's proposed state budget. So there are many who are actively pushing a plan in the legislature to actually completely reject the governor's proposal from the Joint Finance Committee and instead build an entirely new 2017-19 state budget, which is called the base budget, basically starting at zero. So that is being talked about quite a bit right now, so that's why it's very important for school board members to be connecting with legislators, testifying at hearings, because working with the base budget, working from that rather than the governor's proposal, which isn't perfect already, but by going to zero, it erases any of the proposed funding increases and puts us back to square one in the debate. So what that would mean, working base budget, it would mean that instead of starting from increases of 200 or 200 foreign per pupil aid, we would be looking at starting from no increases in either year as the starting point. Because one would presume that lawmakers who are advocating for a zero budget probably have less in mind for schools than the $200 or $204. It's a safe bet. For rural school districts right around here, working from the base budget also means that the targeted increases in sparsity aid and the high-cost transportation aid and the expansion of the sparsity aid to reach schools with sparse student populations less than 1,000 would again not be at that starting point. They'd be at zero, and same for student mental health needs. So very, very, very important that we're connecting and at least advocating that they are going off of the proposed budget and not starting from scratch this late in the game. I also want to make you aware of a few other pieces of legislation that are relevant to us as a district. Jonah in town is advocating for passage of law in the state legislature that would allow 17-year-olds to be tried in criminal proceedings as juveniles. It's called the Second Chance Act. This is relevant to us because we've had youth, particularly in some of our alternative programmings, not just because we serve students who are at the county and other placements, and these laws have detrimentally impacted those youth over the years. And so what this would do is it would keep them in treated as a juvenile in the criminal justice system as a 17-year-old. And also, there is a proposed new bill from our local representative, Dana Walks, called the Voucher Transparency Bill. And he has introduced that, and I would credit President Hombuck Boyle quite a bit for that. I think that she had a lot of conversations with him and his staffer in Madison, Bob. And so they've introduced that, and I basically what that will do is, it would, if passed, it would provide a property tax bill with a supplemental piece of information showing the amount of any new reduction in state aid that is a result of students being enrolled in the voucher program. So basically it would spell out how much we're levying for the voucher system. So that information would help provide transparency for any new tax increase from the school district that was needed to cover the reduction. And the provision would not apply to districts where there are no students enrolled in the program. Also, there is a bill being circulated right now to allow constitutional carry of firearms. That would provide for constitutional carry of firearms so that gun owners can legally own a firearm and would no longer be required to obtain a license in order to carry a concealed firearm in Wisconsin, so they wouldn't need a license to be in specified places. That being said, so long as we have a school zone law in place still, policy here that prohibits it, we're protected for now. But just want you to be aware of that because it would apply to schools that don't have that kind of policy in place. And then also, there are 65 school referenda scheduled tomorrow on the ballot, totaling over $685 million. 29 referenda, 12 recurring, 24 non-recurring. You can see all of them on the DPI website. And speaking of referendums, there are several bills. There are actually 6 bills that have been introduced now that would impact how districts can go to referendums. One would eliminate the ability to go to referendums to exceed revenue limits on a recurring basis. One would require referendums to be scheduled on general election dates. Well, in that case, we're okay. But one would create a general aid penalty for exceeding revenue limits by referendum. And it would allow school boards to rescind revenue limit increases previously approved by referendum. There's one that would put in disclosure of debt issuance, referendum costs, and one that would impose limitations on when operating referendums, debt issuance referendums may be called. And that one specifies, like, if it doesn't pass this year, you have to wait. You can't go right away again. So there are six bills currently that are being labeled as referendum reforms, just so you're aware. And no doubt that's because of the fact that there's just a staggering amount of them. So that's what I have for legislative. There's a lot, but I hope the big takeaway is come with us to the Joint Finance Committee if you can. We'll carpool. What? And vote tomorrow, yes. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Commissioner Luganville. Nice report. So I'm going to take us now to the consent resolution agenda. Most of the things on this agenda, the board is privy to. We've seen information. It's been discussed at previous meetings. I am going to entertain a motion to approve the items en masse. So could I please have a motion to approve the consent resolution agenda?
So moved.
Moved by Commissioner Fager. Second, please. Second. Second by Commissioner Duax. So I entertain the motion to approve the minutes of March 6, 2017. Closed session minutes of March 6, 2017. Minutes of March 27th, 2017. The Human Resources Employment Report. The amended gift reports.
Pull that.
Thanks. The referendum project bids. So can we do a roll call vote on 6.2, 6.3, 6.4, 6.5, and 6.7? Patty?
Commissioner Barstead?
Yes.
Commissioner Duax?
Yes.
Commissioner Fager?
Yes.
Commissioner Hambuck-Boyle?
Yes.
Commissioner Harder?
Yes.
Commissioner Luganville?
Yes.
Commissioner Boo?
Yes.
So we pulled 6.6 amended gift reports. Commissioner Luganville?
I guess I would just maybe like a brief explanation, and then as a follow-up, just for the record, I'd like to see some tightening up of monitoring procedures, whether it's operationally or if there are recommended procedures that need to be added in policy so that this kind of a thing doesn't happen again.
Thank you. And I think, Abby, do you want to kind of talk us through that? I think it's in order to make this a transparent conversation so people know why we made these amendments. So thanks very much.
Sure. Basically, it's very simple. We do have a policy. The gift policy has been in place since 2008. And as part of that policy, a gift form needs to be completed each time a donation is received by the district. In this particular case, that for the $40,500 from the Athletic Booster Club, it was just inadvertently missed. And so when all of the questions came about from the Equity Committee, we went back and looked at records, and the funds were deposited within the district and spent according to plan. The form was just omitted. And then in talking with that, we found that there were a couple of in-kind donations that also were missing. And so that's the purpose of the other two amended gift reports.
Anyone else have a question?
I do.
Commissioner Harder.
I guess just to follow up on Commissioner Luganville's part of his question is, are there plans in terms of monitoring or procedures or something that can help prevent this from happening in the future that are under consideration?
Yes, we are working on some things.
Okay. Thank you. Anyone else? So can we vote on that one then, please? Can someone please put a motion?
So moved.
Second. Second by Commissioner Duax. So can we take a roll call vote, please?
Yes.
Commissioner Duax?
Yes.
Commissioner Fager?
Yes.
Commissioner Hambuck-Boyle?
Yes.
Commissioner Harder?
Yes.
Commissioner Luganville?
Yes.
Commissioner Boo?
Yes.
That takes us to our individual considered resolutions. I'd entertain a motion to put 7.1 on the table, please.
I so move.
So moved by Commissioner Barstead. Second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Fager. Who's going to talk us through this one?
For the secure entrance? Mm-hmm. That would be Mr. Sommerfeld.
Come on up, Larry.
And Mr. Kolop as well. We'll join him.
It was fun to look at the plan. So thanks for that.
I could not figure it out.
How to bring it up? Well, good. Maybe we can bring it up here so we can really have everybody see it. Can we pull it up? Yeah.
To start off, approximately a year and a half ago, we hired an architectural firm, HSR Associates, to prepare preliminary plans and cost estimates for secure entrances at 14 different buildings throughout the district. Those plans were prepared, estimates made, and that was included in the recent referendum that passed. Once the referendum passed, we got together with the principals of the projects that are proceeding first and told them to drag the plans out that they had looked at and get prepared to talk about that and anticipate construction. At Memorial High School, there had been a change in leadership at the building between the initial plan that was done. So I got together with Trevor, went through the concept, the steps that had been done to come up with the preliminary plans. Those plans, we reviewed them, and then we set up a meeting with the architects to start the preliminary planning. When we met with the architects, Trevor said, before we get too far into this, I've had some thoughts. You know, I wasn't part of the initial discussion, but I have some thoughts on another concept to look at. So we discussed it with the architects, determined that it was a concept that would be feasible. So we've spent some time preparing revisions to that concept, trying to tweak it, preparing cost estimates, and that brought us to where we are this evening. The original concept that was prepared had a secure entrance on the east side and another one on the west side of the building. The concept that Trevor asked us to look at was to concentrate the secure entrance on the east side of the building. From a construction standpoint, it does several things. Instead of having construction going on at opposite sides of the building, we're on one side. The secure entrance work that was planned at door four, which is the current main entrance, involved a fair amount of structural renovations to the existing structure to make it work. The work that would be required on the east side is less extensive. So we're getting actually, probably you can say, more bang for the buck by doing a simpler project on one side than doing it on two different sides. So from a construction standpoint, a facility standpoint, we looked at it and determined that the concept was feasible. I'll let Trevor talk about administratively how this impacts Memorial High School.
Well, I can take credit for bringing the idea up. I think the concept was maybe talked about 15 or so years ago. And so when I sat down with Larry and the architects, and then there was another project part of the referendum base that was going on in the back of the building, I just asked the question. I said, has this ever been thought about or looked at? And so that's where the architects kind of, so I can't take like this was my great idea. So from there, it kind of just took off to creating some plans, and then meeting with staff, students, parents to get feedback, perceptions, realities of what it might look like, how it would work. And overwhelmingly in the meetings I had were one secure entrance was much favorable off of our main parking lots opposed to off of our main street, getting closer to Key Street. We still have to use door 4 for bus drop-off, things like that, but if this plan were to go through, it would create a safer, secure entrance, which is the intent of it. It adds a little bit more space to the building. Changes the flow, which we have an idea of how that'll look, but we won't know until we get into it. And that was the open-mindedness, and I know I got a couple staff here that, you know, we might have a scheme or an idea and then change it, but clearly from the students and parents and community standpoint coming into the building, being secure, it seemed to be a better option. So the construction, if the board approves and goes forward, I think it starts in June sometime. And then obviously it would go into the school year because it's a little bit more entailed. So the gym and the school would be functionable once school started, but we'd have some construction that would finalize once school gets going. So
can you be?
Yes.
Can I ask a question? I should have probably said something. When I looked at the plan, the offices that on the east side, they're right in the front, right? Boom, boom, boom.
Correct.
That's what I saw. And so the public end, which entrance, on the right or on the left?
I'm just going to walk up
there. Yeah, can you do that? Because I think the board kind of...
This, you guys are going to see this. This would be our main entrance. Okay? So come in here. Before and after school, it's open. You come in right through the school and you can get in there. Once the school day starts, these doors are locked. You can come in to the attendance office area, check in, and then come into the building. This entrance would also be open before school just because we have a main parking lot over here. But then once the school day starts, everything is shut down. It comes into this large entryway, which feeds into the attendance office. So, many of you know Memorial, our largest two parking lots are here and here for student access and like that. Buses would still drop on Key Street at this point, so door 4 would still be open. Said it was nice was that this is our main entrance and many of our students are back here, so the security of getting to our students is more difficult, obviously, if there was a significant issue. So that's the answer to your question.
Well, and I also want to thank you from the bottom of my heart, and I know the board, and is the collaboration and conversations you had about this with our community and the parents and the kids and Larry. I mean, it sounds pretty collaborative in how you arrived at this possibility.
Yeah, there was a lot of meetings, and I can only take credit for facilitating the parents. I had, I think, almost 30 parents that showed up to a meeting one night. Student council was great. They all came after school when they had activities, and there was 20 some students there. We had different staff listening sessions, getting their input. And what I told folks is, you got an old building. We've added onto it several times. Neither plan is 100% perfect, like it's the greatest, you know. So which one became the most logical long-term that we can work with? And so I think that's where it came to a point of saying, if security and building access and community access is number one in this referendum project, this seems to make the most sense. So that's kind of where we came to.
Commissioner Duex?
Can you show me where the administrative offices would be?
The plan right now will be here, the offices that are made as they come in. So we'd have a conference room, parents, secret meetings, students meetings, and then so. But we will still have plenty of presence back here. So that would be a project of ours, is being in two spots at once between several of us.
Are you around the tennis courts?
The tennis courts are here, about here.
Oh, okay. I wondered, is that a gym there? In that white space?
This is the main game room, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Harder?
What does the purple represent? And then we have two PDFs here with different purple markings on each. They seem
similar.
The
purple is where there are additions. The gray area is where there's renovation.
So in brief, it is the lobby area, and then the other purple areas. We have to relocate like officials' rooms, training rooms, and so that's what the small one in the far corner is across from the pool.
I have a quick question, if I could ask. I love the whole thing. Caught my eye on this map where it says laundry is right near the new entrance, and I've seen a lot of articles lately actually about how schools, elementary, middle, and high schools, have laundry available, a little laundry room available for students to increase student attendance. With that being right near the entrance now and not just in the athletic area, do you think that might be utilized in that way?
I don't anticipate it being open as a student use one. It is used more than just athletics. I would say athletics probably uses it the least. PE uses it, special ed uses it. We wash a lot of our stuff for family consumer science. And actually, it's probably only moving two rooms over from where it currently exists.
Trevor and I have talked, and we understand that we're going to have to do a good job if we proceed with this direction and communicating to the public so that they know what to expect the summer, they know what to expect in the fall. We expect that, the gym and the main hallway and entrance will be available for the start of school in the fall. The main lobby, that is going to probably be a Christmas, New Year's completion time frame.
Commissioner Duex.
Well, I just appreciate your thinking out of the box, Trevor. That's great.
Again, I can't take all the credit. I just came up with the idea, but a lot of people help with this. I mean, between Larry and Dr. Hardebeck and everybody just saying, keep asking questions, get everybody involved. And so that's the one thing I can feel comfortable about is we got a lot of input to make sure we're at least on the right path to doing something.
Okay. Ready to call the question? You want to take a vote, Patty, please?
Commissioner Barstead?
Yes.
Commissioner Duax?
Yes.
Commissioner Fager?
Yes.
Commissioner Hambuck-Boyle?
Yes.
Commissioner Harder?
Yes.
Commissioner Luganbill?
Yes.
Commissioner Buhl?
Yes.
Thanks, Larry. Thanks, Trevor. That moves us on to, we're going to adjourn to committee. We have a ton of policies tonight. I think some of these were under Jim and purview, so we're going to get through all of them. So we'll get to the first one, the discussion and possible first reading of policy 492, the use of visual media in the schools. Your policy and governance committee has been very busy, along with staff, so thanks. Jennifer has to read them all. Actually, there's enough. I think each board member can read one. But so,
making it more contemporary.
Really, the only thing we're doing here is making it right. You want to talk a little bit about it, Joe?
No, I just said it's making it more contemporary. That's with most of these. Mm-hmm. All of these policies, it's making the language more contemporary, more relevant to our process, updating it to be more compliant with statutes, federal laws, and with the samples from School Board Association. And maybe a couple Joe and Chris and Carolyn and Marianne isms thrown in there, but mostly just the recommended.
Jim, can you share who worked on this, please?
Yep. Terry Piper Thompson, Patty Iverson, and James Martin, and myself.
Thank you. Should we
read? And Stan Nesbitt.
And Stan, yeah. You want to read it? Go ahead, Jennifer.
Use of visual media in the schools. State and federal laws safeguarding children and their families against release of student information used by schools or provided by schools to parties external to the school district. Visual media, images, and video of children in the schools are subject to the provision of these laws. The Eau Claire Area School District shall observe measures intended to protect children from their involvement in visual media to which they or their parents or guardians might reasonably object under law.
And Patty, can you go to the bottom so we can see where it's cross-referenced? So it really, since the last time it was revised was 2000. So any questions? Ready to move it on to the consent agenda? Okay. Next one.
Discussion and possible first reading of policy 364.1, student acceptable use of technology.
This is quite a bit longer than the original, mainly because we took most of the rules and added them to the policy to bring it in accordance with the samples that were out there, and just updating the language to be more contemporary and also a little bit more timeless, not specifically naming technologies.
Yep, this one also adds in the SIPA compliance, so, and that's the next piece you're going to talk about, is the removal of that policy.
So you want to start, Aaron, you want to start?
Sure. The Director of Technology shall be responsible for the maintenance and enforcement of rules and procedures concerning the acceptable, safe, and responsible use of the district's internet access infrastructure and other technology-related district resources by any person who is authorized to use the district's systems and equipment, including any student, district employee, district official, or other authorized user, to the extent appropriate to various groups of users, and with such additions as the administration deems necessary or appropriate, those rules and procedures shall, 1, provide notice regarding the district's retention of ownership, control, and oversight of the district's technology and network equipment and resources, specifically to the extent not prohibited by law, and at all times and without further notice, A, individual users are subject to direct and regular district oversight of and district access to any and all data, files, communications, or other materials that they create, store, send, delete, receive, or display on or over the district's internet connection, network resources, file servers, computers, or other equipment. B, all aspects of any individual's use of the district's technology-related equipment and resources, including any online activities that make use of district-provided internet access, are subject to monitoring and tracking by district officials. C, except as to any privacy rights that independently exist under state or federal law, no person who accesses and uses the district's electronic networks and other technology-related equipment and resources does so with an expectation that any privacy right exists that would prevent district officials from, one, monitoring the person's activities, or two, accessing equipment, data, communications, and other materials as described above. Two, provide notice to users that their use of district technology resources is solely at their own risk regarding possible damage to or any other potential loss of data, content, software, or equipment. The district makes no promises or warranties to users regarding potential damage or other loss. Three, prohibit the use of the district's technology-related resources by any person who has not been authorized as a user by school officials. Four, establish rules and expectations related to maintaining a safe, appropriate, and effective learning environment. Five, confirm that all district policies prohibiting bullying, harassment, and discrimination apply with full force to an individual's online and other technology-based activities and communications. Six, address and prohibit the unauthorized collection, disclosure, use, and dissemination of personal and personally identifiable information regarding students, minors, and employees as applicable to technology-based resources. Seven, establish rules and expectations related to accessing and using systems, networks, and data appropriately, including rules A, prohibiting the use of district resources to access and or transmit inappropriate material via the internet, electronic mail, or other forms of electronic communications, and B, prohibiting unauthorized access to systems, networks, and data. Eight, establish rules and procedures related to requests to temporarily adjust levels of internet filtering, blocking, where there is a demonstrated educational purpose, and the request is otherwise consistent with district policies and applicable law. Nine, provide notice to users regarding possible consequences for violations of the policy, rules, and procedures that govern the acceptable, safe, and responsible use of the district's technology-related resources. Consequences may include the suspension, restriction, or revocation of the privilege or use of use or access, the imposition of other disciplinary action by the district, and or referral to law enforcement. 10, provide means for documenting each user's receipt and acceptance of the terms and conditions under which they may be authorized to use the district's technology-related resources.
You can take a breath now.
Thank you.
The administration shall take steps to ensure that instruction or training activities and reasonable structure and systemic supports are in place to facilitate and enforce individual users' compliance with the district's policies, rules, and procedures that govern the acceptable, safe, and responsible use of the district's technology-related resources, appropriately limiting a user's access rights to be consistent with the individual's role and authority of district technology resources is a privilege that requires each user to take an appropriate degree of personal responsibility for following district rules and procedures and for using sound judgment in his or her communications and other technology-related personal conduct and activities. Additional provisions regarding internet safety, consistent with applicable federal laws, including the Children's Internet Protection Act, student internet safety involves a combination of technology protection measures, monitoring, and instruction. It shall be the responsibility of the Director of Technology, in consultation with such designees as they deem appropriate, to 1. Ensure that the district systems and equipment that provide access to the internet make active use of technology protection measures designed to block or filter internet access. 2. Visual depictions that are A. obscene, B. pornographic, or C. as to computers and other devices that may be accessed by students or other minors, otherwise harmful to minors. Filtering, blocking, or other protective technologies will also be used to decrease the likelihood that student users of the district systems and equipment might access materials or communications other than visual depictions that are inappropriate for students. 2. Develop and implement an instructional program that is designed to educate students about acceptable and responsible use of technology and safe and appropriate online behavior, including A. safety and security issues that arise in connection with various forms of electronic communication, B. information about interacting with other individuals, C. cyberbullying awareness and response. Such educational activities shall vary by the instructional level of the students and shall include, but shall not consist exclusively of, reinforcement of the provisions of the district's specific rules regarding students' acceptable and responsible use of technology while at school. It shall be the responsibility of all members of the Eau Claire Area School District to supervise and monitor usage of the online computer network and access to the internet in accordance with this policy and the Children's Internet Protection Act. Building principals and their designees shall have responsibility within their respective schools for overseeing the day-to-day implementation of the district's policies, rules, and guidelines regarding the acceptable, safe, and responsible use of technology resources. That's what I didn't read it, so it's not in there. We left it out from the minutes.
Any comments, suggestions, discussion? Are we ready to move that one upward? Okay. On to the next one.
We don't need to read it if people are okay with it. We just bring it to the next one to rescind it.
Okay. The one after that is...
So if there are no objections.
Are there any objections to... Is this the one we're rescinding?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Everybody okay with that? All right, next one. What are we on to? 771, use of copyrighted materials.
This is much more flexible. In terms of how we judge media through the fair use standards.
Yep.
Use of copyrighted material, 771.1. The Eau Claire Area School District must adhere to the requirements of U.S. copyright law, Title 17, United States Code, Section 101. It is the intention of the school board that all copyright laws be observed in the district. It is also the intention of the board to inform teachers and students of related copyright guidelines and to promote adherence to them. Staff members and students are also expected to actively seek guidance and direction from a library media specialist, an administrator, or the district's copyright officer, library media coordinator, in the event of any uncertainty regarding the appropriate and lawful use of copyrighted materials. It is the responsibility of course instructors to be familiar with copyright laws and to instruct students in responsible use of images, audio, and print materials. The district shall assume no liability for infringement of copyright by individual employees and others using equipment in violation of this policy. Specifically, no person shall unlawfully duplicate, reproduce, distribute, or display copyrighted materials in connection with any district-sponsored activity on district property or using district equipment or technology resources regardless of medium. Possible violations of copyright laws occurring within the district shall be brought to the attention of the district copyright officer. Copyrighted materials or media may be used or copied only when such use or copying constitutes a fair use as defined by law or with the prior written permission of the copyright holder. Four factors shall be considered in determining whether or not a particular use is fair under the federal copyright law. Number one, the purpose and character of the use, including whether such use is of a commercial nature or is for nonprofit educational purposes. Number two, the nature of the copyrighted work. Number three, the amount and substantiality of the portion used in relation to the copyrighted work as a whole. The effect of the use upon the potential market for or value of the copyrighted work. Notices of copyright restrictions shall be placed on and or near photocopiers. They shall also be posted on the district web pages along with links to other resources regarding use of copyrighted works.
Thank you very much. Any comments? Commissioner Lugenbill?
Just want people to know when we read about the district copyright officer, that's Stan Nesbitt, because it aligns with his role with instructional media. So that's part of his, one of his hats.
Commissioner
He
Duet.
Needs a badge for it. You're right.
Commissioner Duet.
Well, that was one of my questions, yeah. But I take this very, very seriously because I was the national officer of the National Association of Teachers of Singing, and one of the favorite things to do is to copy music. Mm-hmm. My organization had people who were thought it was so ridiculous that we didn't allow that. But we had to be so serious about that because the individual would not be sued, but our organization would be.
Right.
So I suggest if we don't have any kind of a workshop for teachers and students, that we have that. That we do literally what it asks us to do is to post at copy machines and things like that. And so I urge you to take it very seriously.
Thank you. Anyone else? Are you ready to move that one on? And then are you okay then to take recent policy 363, which is 17 years old, the one we replaced, okay? So then we go on to discussion and possible first reading of new policy 522.7, staff use of information technology and communication. Does anybody want to volunteer to read that one?
Is it short pen?
I can do that.
Okay. You go, girl. What, I'll
get, you,
well, can Catherine?
Can I make a quick comment?
Next one.
Can I make a quick comment?
Yeah.
Just to be aware that also part of the rescinding of 363 was because we changed the numbering. We followed the WASB numbering to the 700 series because it's not just instruction, as Commissioner Duax referred to, that applied to the entire organization's behavior. So that was the reason for the rescinding. And likewise, this next pair is another one where the numbering is changing because of WASB, and so that's why there's the rescinding happening after the other one.
Okay.
I would delightfully defer to Commissioner Duax if she would prefer to read this.
Okay. Yep. Yep. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Staff use of information technology and communication resources, 522.7. The district provides staff with access to information technology and communication resources to accomplish its mission of educating students, and use of same shall be carried out in a responsible manner in accordance with established board policies and rules outlined in the employee handbook. Users of district information technology and communications resources shall have no expectation of privacy with respect to such use. Consequently, all software, email, voicemail, files, digital communications, and other information or documents used, generated, transmitted, or received over district data, voice, or video networks, or stored on district equipment are the property of the district. The district retains the right to review, monitor, audit, intercept, access, and disclose all messages or information created, received, or sent over district data, voice or video networks, or stored on its equipment. Additionally, these messages or information may be subject to release in accordance with applicable public records law. Where am I? The administration shall create and enforce rules for use of information technology and communication resources. Policy or rule violations may result in one or more of the following. One, restriction of access to district information technology and communication resources. Two, appropriate disciplinary action up to and including discharge. And three, referral of the matter to law enforcement authorities.
Thank you. Any questions or discussion? Are you ready to move that one then? And then we already talked about the rescinding of 527 as per Jim's explanation. Are you all okay with that? Commissioner Luganville, do you want to say something?
Well, I'll just explain the next one if there's no objections to
go.
The...
Yep, go right ahead.
This one we don't have to read anything. It's just adding an exhibit per DPI. So there's actually nothing to read.
And that same exhibit had actually been approved several years ago by the board to adopt that policy for retention schedule of documents. It just never was included, as Commissioner Luganville said, as an exhibit.
Okay. Any not questions? Huh?
Yeah.
Commissioner Duex? You're late.
No, I'm sorry.
That's all right. I caught you that time. That's pretty good. Mm-hmm. So that brings us the close of our committee reports. Requests for future agenda items. Does anybody have any? I had one, and I just wanted to bring up the kindergarten concerns. So that we just received some information on. So I put that on there.
Do you want that as a committee or as a written report?
Since it's the preliminary discussion, I guess it doesn't matter to me how we get it, but does anybody else want to weigh in?
It might be helpful to give you some background information.
Okay.
And some response to the concerns that were in the letter, and then you can determine whether or not you want to
commit
a report.
Perfect. All right. Mm-hmm. Commissioner Luganville?
I have an additional one, too. Just now that we're in the staffing process and in light of what was brought up in the public forum, just maybe some sort of a written report about what determines having a team teacher in place versus an aide in a classroom and how class size plays a role in that at the elementary level, just for my information and for our information.
And before we, is that anybody else? And before we adjourn, Patty, I did not bring my, who is part of agenda setting, so who's the?
Well, it's Catherine.
Oh. Okay, so we just need a third person to volunteer.
I'll do it.
Who said that? Oh, Jennifer? Okay. So I got to pull out my calendar here so we can at least get that date and then we can adjourn our meeting. Or do you want to, if it's the three of us, you want to set a date after we adjourn? Okay, let's, anybody want to move to adjourn the meeting, please?
So moved.
Second.
So moved by Commissioner Fager, second by Commissioner Vu. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you very much.
This program is recorded and presented by Chippewa Valley Community Television. Chippewa Valley Community Television is made possible by continuing community support. If you would like to volunteer or make a donation, you can contact us by calling 715-839-5067. Or on the web at www.cbctv.org.